homicide investigation. We thought you were supposed to interview the eyewitnesses.
Hi, my name is Daniel Hopsicker. Welcome to Mohammed, Atta, and the Venice Flying Circus. I'm standing in front of the Venice, Florida airport. There is a massive conspiracy going on right now in Florida to cover up what happened on these runways before September 11th. We're being lied to about the nature of the conspiracy that took down the World Trade Center. Lied to by the FBI, lied to by our president, lied to even by our media. For example, PBS's Frontline documentary on September 11th began with this line: 19 hijackers moved through Europe and America unnoticed. In a pig's eye, they did. In the lobby of the Central Intelligence Agency's headquarters in McLean, Virginia, there is this inscription: "Ye shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." This is a story about legends. Your legend is your cover story in intelligence parlance, the lie that holds together long enough to let you slip away. The legends of Rudy Deckers as flight school owner and Mohammed Atta as fanatic Islamic fundamentalist have been fraying at the edges since the collapse of the World Trade Center. But what you'll see tonight will leave you asking the same question we are. Who are these guys? Tonight you'll hear the voices of some important eyewitnesses to the September 11th attack. Eyewitnesses not to the World Trade Center disaster, but to the prelude to the tragedy, to the conspiracy in progress in Florida, which 2 years ago resulted in a massive influx of Arab pilot trainees.
Many times I went to lunch with these folks, and some of them could hardly speak English. Some of them are from Liberia or Libya, and various countries in the Middle East.
But you've been a pilot in this area for 15 years.
Yeah.
Has that always been the case?
No, this is a recent influx of these type of trainees.
You'll also discover that Atta and his buddies acted a lot like characters right out of Miami Vice.
They were loud, you know, making comments at the hand on the table, this kind of thing. We're talking $200,000. We have to answer to the family. I thought it was mafia.
And you'll learn that the man largely responsible for this massive influx, flight school owner Rudy Deckers, is not who he pretends to be.
And what I heard was just that he had a backer in Naples that was backing him financially. That the money that he had, that he, in a sense, flaunted, was not even his money. He was just the front man for the man that had the money.
To learn the truth, you have to journey to an unlikely and until recently little known center of intrigue, a freebooting port of call for an international cast of Learjet setting rogues, spies, villains, and terrorists. Set beside a community of golf playing retirees looking to get in on the early bird special. Welcome to Venice, Florida, a tiny retirement community on Florida's Gulf Coast. Like most towns, Venice has a few things to boast about. It bills itself as the shark tooth capital of the world, for example. And it has the second oldest population per capita in the entire United States. But it's really just a pleasantly ordinary little place. Except that Arab terrorists by the dozens came here to learn to fly. Mohammed Atta piloted the plane that hit the first tower. He learned to fly here. Marwan al-Shehhi flew into the second tower less than half an hour later. He learned to fly here too. So did Siad al-Jarrah at the controls of the plane that crashed in Pennsylvania. That's 3 out of 4. And so did the most wanted terrorist still alive from the Hamburg cadre, Ramzi bin Shalbib. What drew them here? Why would healthy young men gravitate to a retirement community anywhere, where what bathing beauties there are recall in earlier, gentler time? It makes you wonder, because it ain't Hamburg. How exactly did Venice, Florida become the biggest September 11th crime scene that wasn't reduced to rubble? Were they sent here? Was it an assignment? Who was Mohammed Atta anyway? Islamic fundamentalist, terrorist ringleader, the Pied Piper of terrorist pilots? How about Arab spy or double agent? The Pelican Alley is owned and run by Renee Adorna and her husband Tom. When reporters showed up the day after September 11th, she immediately knew why they were there.
Right after the incident happened, we had newspapers come down, and somebody said, oh, there's a reporter out there. And right away, I knew what it was about because I remembered the table. Tommy knew, Jeff knew, we said right away. And then he didn't even really, he showed one picture and we knew immediately. There was three and they all looked of the, I guess, Egyptian, like kind of dark skin, dark hair, lots of jewelry, lots of jewelry. They're dressed like in Florida type shirts, you know, the silk with the pattern and that kind of thing. And I could have swore there was a cross. The one guy had the big cross. You know, the big gaudy gold cross thing, I thought. But I'm not sure now. But I know it was just he had the big watch on.
When you saw pictures afterwards, did you recognize all three?
One? No, just three, one. Two? I only recognized one of them. The Atta, I guess is his name.
Atta, the ringleader?
Yeah.
The guy with the 1,000-yard stare.
Right. He was he barely spoke a word to me. But when I'd come over, I'd be like, geez, what's his problem? Because he had that really mean look on his face all the time, like he was very unhappy. So
yeah,
you know,
I keep hearing
so I mean, he never really spoke. And then the other guy was a heavier set guy who did all the talking, you know, with me anyway. Was very outgoing, was very you know, pleasant actually. So
and who was Atta arguing with?
The big guy.
The heavy set guy.
Mm-hmm. And actually the big guy was actually yelling at the other guy.
Atta and his young sidekick weren't arguing over the proper interpretation of the Quran.
They were loud, you know, making comments at the hand on the table, this kind of thing. We're talking $200,000. We have to answer to the family. I thought it was mafia. You know, like when I'd walk by, I just, you know, and I tried to stay away from the table pretty much, and then went and told the owner and the manager, you'd better watch this table. They're getting a little out of hand.
And they came in into the office and said there was three gentlemen out here getting very loud and having arguments amongst each other, and she was afraid that it might get too out of control, so she came and got me, and I came out here. They were sitting right here. The way they were sitting was, the one guy was on one side, the other guy was here, and then the big guy, he wasn't even in the booth, he was sitting on a chair on the outside here. He was a pretty big guy.
Mm-hmm.
And he was doing most of the talking and just kept talking and saying stuff to them and kept hearing about money and things about money. And the other guy that I guess was the main guy, he wasn't saying a word. He just sat there with a look on his face the whole time.
The FBI come see you?
No. Two newspapers, that was it.
But nobody?
No.
No cops, no Venice police?
No. And they were right down the street at the house. The house was right down the block that they had rented. So they never came over here to see us.
Did the FBI come talk to you afterwards?
Did what?
Did the FBI come talk to you afterwards?
No, actually only newspaper people.
Strange.
Yeah, I did, because we thought, you know, geez, they might want some information or something, but maybe they already had everything
that they needed.
They needed, yeah.
The FBI never finished its investigation into the September 11th disaster. Their work was halted by President Bush in an effort, he said, to free more manpower for the anthrax investigation. Well, the anthrax is behind us now. 3,000 dead people command us to find the truth about how it is they came to die on September 11th in the year 2001. And it's the search for that truth that's brought us here, where on these runways, barely 18 months ago, Mohammed Atta joined the Venice Flying Circus. A glimpse into the private lives of cold-blooded killers left us wanting to know much more. The obvious question, of course, is what kind of fanatic Islamic fundamentalist wear silk shirts and heavy gold watches? More importantly, who or what is the family? The FBI had managed to pop in at Atta and Marwan's rented home in Venice, a block from the Pelican Alley. It's owned by this man, Steve Kona, a Venice fireman.
What they did was they come to the rental house itself. I guess the FBI showed up there about a day or two afterwards. I just maintained the grass over there in the summer, and they actually dealt with the rental agency for the, you know, for the rent each month.
Right.
But yeah, I would see him occasionally when I was over there mowing.
Mohammed Atta apparently disdained contact with almost everyone.
Actually, he kept kind of secluded. His cousin, which I can't think of
how. Chubby guy.
Yeah, I talked to him a couple times when I was over there mowing. He was friendly.
Everyone
but
says that.
Yeah, and he was Mohammed Atta. Nah. I never spoke with him. 6 months he was there.
The terrorist landlord is clear about the time period during which they rented the home. The same July through December time period of the year before the attack.
They rented just for that 6 months, where the same amount of time that they were here for the
for the pilot's training, and then they left. I didn't, you know, of course, I didn't have any dealings with them, so I didn't know where they went after that. But that, you know, my understanding, I thought they were going back to their country. I thought they were here just for the training, then they were leaving.
We've just heard eyewitnesses that they were in this Venice restaurant just a month or so before September 11th. The timeline doesn't mesh. Because when the FBI explains where the terrorists were in this country during the last 9 months of their conspiracy, the word Venice does not pass their lips. Was there something in Venice we weren't supposed to find? Brenda Cover works in the deli of this supermarket a mile from the airport. She says the terrorist pilots were in Venice just 1 week before the attack.
September 11th, I was on the phone with my mother-in-law the same time the buildings got hit. They showed pictures of three different guys. Atta was one of them on TV. Uh-huh. And immediately I recognized the faces. Uh-huh. And I told my husband then, oh my God, those are the three guys. They were just in the store a week ago. The week before that, they were in the store. They got subs.
Who were they meeting? Why were they here? The official story is that Mohammed Atta's terrorist cadre's appearance in Venice was nothing more than mere happenstance. Is that true? Again, we heard mention of Atta's dark presence.
I didn't like the way they stared at you. I mean, it would have been different if they would have talked to you like you were a normal person and, yeah. And just, hi, how are you today? But he just stood back and just glared at you with his dark eyes like you were the bad person. You know, like he wanted to do you harm or something. And it just really gave you a frightening, eerie feeling. Like I wouldn't want to be caught in the parking lot at night with him.
We asked Brenda when she first noticed the flood of Arab pilots coming through Venice.
About a year ago.
Was it just happenstance that so many young Arab men began arriving in Venice for pilot training all at about the same time? Because if it wasn't, then something else was going on in Venice, Florida. Something which the FBI may be doing its best to ignore. Venice is worlds away from Miami Vice. Atta and his Arab cadre seem to fit right in on Florida's East Coast, the center of Casablanca-type intrigue, with trendy eateries packed with tall European models. It's a rapish sort of place where even Osama bin Laden could find an aircraft broker who would sell him a U.S. jet trainer. This is the Fort Lauderdale Executive Airport, famous as a safe harbor for pirates of the air. This company, for example, used to work out of the infamous Mena, Arkansas airport, known as a haven for aviation intrigue during the 1980s. Just blocks from this airport, Mohammed Atta rented a car for what would be the last month of his life. Incredibly, he used it to return to Venice. As we've seen in the FBI's official chronology, the word Venice does not appear in the story of Mohammed Atta's final days. But in the rental cars that Mohammed Atta and Marwan rented right behind me here, they went to Venice twice.
He rented two cars over three different contracts, a total of about 5 weeks. Five. He picked up that car at closing time, and that one was going to be for 2 weeks. He told me it was going to be for 2 weeks, and told me he had to go over the west coast of Florida and wanted to know if that would be a problem.
In this nondescript building in Pompano Beach, Florida, we got confirmation that Atta had been in Venice during two of the last 3 weeks of his life.
While he was over in Venice during those 2 weeks, he called me from Venice. I saw it on the caller ID, and I thought, oh, wonderful, I got a car broke down over on the west coast of Florida. And he called me because the service engine soon light was on.
During his questioning by the FBI, Warwick learned new details of the attack.
Well, Marwan almost missed the building, so FBI told me that he was flying 100. Marwan was flying 100 miles an hour faster than Atta, and that's why he flew into the building deeper. And that's why that building came down first, is because there was so much fuel deeper into the building. But their also explanation is Atta was very cool, calm, collected, just zeroed right in on it, just bingo. And Marwan, on the other hand, 10 years younger, was just scared to death. And flying, he flew erratic, and like I say, at the last minute, he almost even missed the building.
Numerous items in Warwick's account are at odds with the official story. Atta had supposedly never been to America before. Atta had supposedly never been to America before the previous summer, which is hardly enough time to learn to speak without an accent.
How was their English?
Both of them very good.
Yeah.
Very. I really thought that they had been in the country for a long time.
Where and when did Mohammed Atta learn to speak like he'd been here a long time? Everywhere we turned, we heard anomalous evidence.
Mohammed dressed to the nines. I mean, you know, nice pants, shirt, just business-like. Real business appearing, but nice clothes.
The biggest mass murderer of the new century posed, ironically, as the perfect consumer.
He carried a briefcase, and he had all the credentials he needed. I mean, we asked for, in order to rent a car to anybody, they got to have credit card, driver's license, and proof of insurance, and he had that. Everything matched. He had Allstate insurance. Address on the insurance card matched his driver's license. And he was a perfect customer.
Warwick remains puzzled by certain inconsistencies in the terrorist's actions. More anomalous evidence.
If they're on a suicide mission, they know they were going to be gone in a couple days. Number one, why would you go to the trouble to return the car to us 2 days before? If you got to catch a flight, like say out of Fort Lauderdale Airport to go up north, why don't you just leave the car at the airport? The heck with me. We already had a signed credit card slip. We could have put it on that credit card slip and saved yourself the aggravation. And who do you care? Why do you, what would you care? They bothered returning the car here. And on the last contract, we already had a signed credit card slip for Mohammed. And Marwan said, no, don't put it on his credit card. Here, put it on mine. Well, in order for us to take somebody else's credit card on a contract, you got to be on the contract. So that means he had to give us his driver's license, and he'd had to sign everything. No problem. He gave us his driver's license, got on the credit card, tore up Mohammed's credit card slip, charged it on Marwan. I mean, what all does this make if you're going to be dead in a couple of days? What difference does all this make?
Warwick, too, noticed a high tide of suspicious characters.
I have given them a lot of names because this last year I've had a lot of people that, after this 9/11, I go, whoa, what about that? Remember that customer? And what about that customer? It's three young guys that just prior to September rented a car from me for 3 months. And to me, they fit the description of anything that Mohammed was up to. I mean, why would they spend $900 a month to rent a car from me? What would they be up to? Why were they here?
As with almost everything else about September 11th, Bradley Warwick's story has a twist. We asked him how Mohammed Atta had found his tiny agency.
How did they find you? Their credit, you know.
Oh, it's out of the phone book. Yeah.
But in the Bell South Yellow Pages, there is, alas, no listing for Warwick's. More anomalous evidence. Neither is his company listed at the Florida Division of Corporations. But we did discover several IRS liens he has outstanding. Maybe that's why we weren't too surprised when he told us he's worked with the FBI before.
I've been involved with other FBI situations in the past.
For the last 6 weeks of his life, terrorist ringleader Mohammed Atta left the jazzier precincts of the Miami area to journey across the state to a retirement community with the second oldest population in the entire U.S., Venice. Did Mohammed Atta have a secret preference for blue-haired widows over tall European models? If he did, it'd be a big surprise. Atta frequented this Sarasota strip joint, conveniently located next to a nearby dog track. A young man with money to burn, Mohammed Atta enjoyed very un-Islamic lap dances here, and also at places like the Pink Pony Strip Club in Daytona Beach, and the Olympic Garden, a grind joint on the seedier end of the strip in Las Vegas. Stuffing $20 bills into the panties of topless dancers must be frowned on, don't you think, by fundamentalist Saudi mullahs? But it wasn't all seedy strip clubs. When not ogling infidel flesh, Atta had a taste for the finer things as well, like hanging out at Harry's Bar in New York, for example, where he preferred a table near the piano. We can see someone, an Arab spy, for example, having a preference for a table near the piano at Harry's Bar, but an Islamic fundamentalist? 3 nights before the attack, Mohammed Atta, Marwan Shehi, and Siad al-Jarrah drank at this Fort Lauderdale bar. It gained immediate notoriety. Federal agents flashed pictures of the terrorist pilots who just a day earlier had demolished the World Trade Center to the manager Tony Amos and Patricia Adrisi, the bartender. We were able to recognize both gentlemen, Amos said. Atta drank Stolichnaya vodka for 3 straight hours, the bartender remembered. Marwan al-Shehi was drinking rum. They were very rude, she said. They didn't want to pay the bill. When asked if they could afford the $48 bar tab, Atta pulled out a thick roll. Mohammed said he worked for American Airlines and he could pay the bill, she told reporters. The guy Mohammed was drunk, Amos said. A week later, Amos changed his story. Mohammed Atta drank nothing stronger than cranberry juice that evening at Chuckum's Raw Bar. Night manager Tony Amos now said, he was sitting quietly by himself. Take a look at this picture. Do you think the restaurant manager changed his story because he mistook Atta for someone else? We wanted to ask him, but when we stopped by, neither he nor bartender Idrizi were there any longer. The current bartender, before she realized she'd said too much, indicated their leaving was somehow 9/11 related. Life in Venice must have been hell for someone with Atta's jet-set tastes. Atta must have chafed. No wonder everyone ragged on his bad attitude. But was Venice his choice? Why did Mohammed Atta and so many other 9/11 principals come here? His three trips to Venice in the last 6 weeks of his life must have been business. Who was he meeting? Local law enforcement officials indicated to us that they too would like to know that answer. And that's when our search led us to begin looking into this man, flight school owner Rudy Deckers, responsible 2 years ago for an influx of literally hundreds of Arab pilot trainees. This then is the central dramatic question to our story, to the tragedy of September 11th. Did Arab men just wander up and down the Gulf Coast of Florida as easily as if they'd been listening to Tom Petty albums all their lives? Or were they assisted by a global network? If they were, Rudy Deckers would be the place to look. In the aftermath of the tragedy, Deckers was everywhere on television, portraying himself as just an innocent businessman, victimized by the perpetrators of one of history's greatest crimes. Is he? The first thing we heard about Rudy Deckers came from a female researcher who called to tell us he sounded phony to her in his television appearances, that there was something odd about him. Was it female intuition? He sounded sincere enough to us.
This morning at 7 o'clock, I heard what happened, and the first thing I questioned myself was if I would have known. I would kill him by my own bare hands. If I have a Muslim coming in right now, I think that I'm going to be a human being and tell him, get the hell out of my property here.
The day that all this occurred, we felt very, very sad, like all the other Americans.
Deckers isn't American, he's Dutch. And his response to pass the buck on to unnamed underlings sounds a little rehearsed.
How was it that you first came in contact with these men?
I have heard yesterday from my employees, because I don't have contact with every student that walks in, that these two individuals came in July in 2000, checked our facility, said that they were flying in another facility in Tampa. They were not happy at that facility. They came back after a couple of days and decided that they wanted to fly with us.
That seems a simple, straightforward chronology. But compare it with the words of the chief flight instructor at Jones Aviation in nearby Sarasota, Florida, who tells another story altogether.
It was on or about June of, would have been 2000. They came up from Huffman Aviation. It's not our policy normally to enroll students from other schools. It has to pretty much be an exception. And in their case, I did make an exception for the reasons they gave me.
Deckers said terrorist ringleader Atta was already an experienced pilot when he arrived at Huffman Aviation.
So were they learning to fly from square one, essentially?
No, Mr. Atta had a private pilot license already, and I see he, if I pronounce right, he had only a few hours. They did a private pilot license with us, single-engine commercial and multi-engine commercial.
But we soon heard this statement totally contradicted. More anomalous evidence.
Atta was already a pilot. He already had a private pilot's license. Isn't that right?
Not when he came here, no. He was close to getting a private license. He had three-quarters of the course complete.
The same course that Marwan was taking?
Yeah.
But but there was no discernible difference in training skills and skills events between the two?
Between the two. Atta was the better pilot of the two. But both of them, I mean, looking at them both as two students learning together, where they were in the curriculum when they came here, they should have been a lot further along.
The FBI, we learned, had known about terrorist training at Rudy Decker's flight school for some time, which probably accounts for their swift response.
The FBI visited you just a few hours ago and confiscated some records. Can you tell us about that?
It was yesterday, 2:30 a.m. They called my managers here in Venice and wanted to see two files. I came in at 7 o'clock in the morning. They were still there. I talked briefly with them.
They were ready to go. I told them that we have more customers, clients from the Middle East, and I thought it was a good idea to give them all my files. So I gave them a couple of hundred files from the last years.
The contents of the files of Rudy Decker's flight school might answer some persistent questions about the terrorist conspiracy's operations in Florida, and even reveal what kind of help they may have received in this country and from whom. But these questions haven't been answered because the FBI hasn't talked about what's in them. One Venice law enforcement official told us they, the FBI, loaded two Ryder trucks right outside the police station, then drove the trucks right onto a C-130 military cargo plane at Sarasota Airport, which flew out with Jeb Bush aboard. Since the FBI is not talking, maybe somebody should ask Jeb Bush. Then the cat got out of the bag just a little bit, as it sometimes does in the immediate aftermath of a major event.
Let me ask you this. One of these men is widely considered to be responsible for a bus bombing in Israel. How was it that they could gain access, admittance, to your school?
Well, they didn't came through our paperwork like they're calling from Europe, and we know 2 months ahead that they're showing up. As I said, they came from another flight school out of Florida. Probably that flight school did all the INS paperwork with them in their country.
Authorities immediately denied that the Mohammed Atta, who masterminded the demolition of the World Trade Center, was the same Mohammed Atta who had 15 years earlier blown up an Israeli bus. So there apparently were two separate Arab terrorists with the exact same name. But then we discovered a story from September 15th's Washington Post stating Mohammed Atta had been to International Officer School at Maxwell Air Force Base in Montgomery, Alabama, and that others of the terrorists had attended the Aerospace Medical School at Brooks Air Force Base in Texas and the Defense Language Institute in Monterey, California. Three of the terrorists had even listed their address on their driver's license as the Naval Air Station in Pensacola, Florida, the story went on, where they participated in military exchange programs for foreign officers at the Pensacola Naval Air Station. Foreign nationals who became terrorist pilots were training at U.S. military facilities they would most likely have had connections to Arab governments considered friendly to the United States. And that's a big story. But when the Post story ran, authorities denied it too. So now, apparently, there are three separate Mohammed Attas. Imagine that. Rudy Deckers was quick to disclaim any responsibility. He was just an innocent businessman, he told reporters.
And I know it's difficult because you, in some sense, feel a little bit of responsibility, don't you?
No, we don't feel responsible for what happened at all. Not nothing.
The terrorists were only in Venice for a short time before moving on to Florida's East Coast, Decker said.
I have learned yesterday that after November 2000, that they left this facility and went to a flight school in Pompano Beach where they had additional training for jets.
In later interviews, his story remained much the same.
Atta and Al-Sihi walked into the front door, and we have no obligation whatsoever to do any background checks or passports or ID.
So who was to blame for the terrorist presence in our midst? Exactly 6 months later, Rudy Deckers, oddly enough, helped provide the answer.
Exactly 6 months after the September 11th terrorist attacks, the man who trained two of the terrorists to fly got some unexpected paperwork in the mail.
Yesterday, Rudy Decker of Huffman Aviation in Venice received the visa application approvals for hijackers Mohammed Atta and Marwan Al-Shehi.
Because of some strangely suspicious timing, Rudy got to use the V word right on television. Vindicated.
I don't expect on a Monday morning when I come in and I open my mail to get two permits from Atta and Al-Sihi. I thought they were already past me. We applied for the right paperwork, and therefore I'm happy I can do that now.
So you feel vindicated?
Yes.
And suddenly the finger of blame was beginning to point towards the lowly INS.
Decker says he was not surprised to receive the paperwork on Atta and Al-Shehi 7 months after he sent it in. He said that's actually a short time. He says the process can sometimes take up to 2 years. The INS, meanwhile, is embarrassed by this whole situation and in a release statement says that, quote, the current system for collection and tracking information on students is outdated, inaccurate, and obsolete.
Thank God for hard-hitting American journalism. Deckers got major public relations mileage out of the INS snafu. We suppose only a cynic would wonder if someone had planned it this way.
The flight schools didn't do anything wrong. The government needs to look at itself and look at procedures, what they can change, so this would not happen anymore.
But when the Dutch national whose flight school was the terrorist American beachhead was invited to testify before Congress about his views on preventing a recurrence of September 11th, it struck some observers as being a little much. Rudy and CNN seemed to have quite a meeting of the minds. Rudy was now even advising Congress, just as he had earlier offered help and advice to the FBI. The story helped to focus public anger over the terrorist attack.
Venice residents like Ralph Hargis know that the arrival of the applications couldn't have stopped September 11th, but they believe a more diligent INS should have.
Someone's dragging their feet somewhere.
They let them into this country, we paid the price.
Still, some people in Venice had other ideas about where the real blame lay.
When people in town found out that these people had been in our midst right here,
mm-hmm.
I mean, three of them.
They wanted to go burn down the airport.
The INS debacle left even mainstream reporters skeptical, if not downright embarrassed.
Well, maybe I missed this while I was shaking my head, but explain again, because I read it. I'm not sure I understand what the INS is saying here. At some point, fairly recently, somehow these pages got stuck in an envelope and sent down to Florida. Now, did anybody look at them?
Apparently not. You'd think those names, Atta, Al-Shehi, which are in the news, probably more than anybody's, would stand out.
More hard-hitting American journalism. Before anyone pins any medals on Rudy Dekkers, we think they should take a look at what people who know him have got to say. For starters, he has a pretty tarnished local history. Coy Jacobs owns an aviation business right next to Rudy Dekkers at the Venice Airport.
He was operating a flight school, an unsuccessful flight school in Naples. He had some run-ins with the FAA. I think he had lost his license or had been reprimanded.
Also, it turns out he's something of a deadbeat. Bob Mudge writes for the local Venice Gondolier.
I don't think I knew anything at all about Rudy, even his taking over of Huffman, until April or maybe early May of last year when he missed a rent payment. Actually, I found out he was behind on several months' rent. The only, at that time, fixed-base operator at the Venice Municipal Airport was, I think, at that time, 3 months behind in his rent and had gotten a demand letter of being threatened with eviction.
There was even something strangely puzzling about the circumstances under which Dekkers had purchased Huffman Aviation.
They did no due diligence, to the best of my knowledge. It's a cardinal no-no. I mean, you just don't come in and buy a business like that. They blew into town. They were here a day or two, met with Stan Huffman. He named a number. They said yes, wrote him a check. Stan left. They're here. And then they notified the city of Venice what they did after the fact. And it was a shock to everybody at the airport. In fact, the city council and the city attorney, and I think even for that matter, the manager of the airport wasn't even aware of the fact. And that's a criteria. You can't transfer properties at this airport and most federally funded airports without the governing authority's approval.
The city of Venice wasn't the only government agency eager to bend the rules for Rudy Dekkers.
Rudy is not a U.S. national citizen. He's not national. I don't believe he's a U.S. citizen. And historically, the FAA is pretty picky about who they allow to even own November-registered or U.S.-registered airplanes. A non-U.S. citizen cannot register an airplane in the United States, can't own it in the United States.
And yet, as we will soon learn, Dekkers owned not just U.S.-registered airplanes, but a U.S. chartered airline as well.
He was involved in the startup of Flair, I think it was called, which was Florida Airline, simply. And I know he had a lot of problems with that. I think it was briefly in service, but Flair's period of service was pretty brief. There's a level beyond which we don't really go into for a lot of reasons. We don't have the staff. Stories get beyond our scope. I've heard a lot of things about why that airline went into trouble, and there were a lot of financial problems, and I've heard problems with people not getting paid. And I had some discussions with Dekkers about that at some point, and he was blaming it on I forget who.
And that's when we began to learn about Rudy Dekkers' shadowy financing.
And what I heard was just that he had a backer in Naples that was backing him financially. That the money that he had that he, in a sense, flaunted was not even his money. He was just the front man for the man that had the money.
The only way I could explain it, and the only way it was explained to me, was that Rudy Dekkers was running an unsuccessful business in Naples. He was not making any money. He had he didn't have the best of reputation.
Somehow, Rudy Dekkers' financial profile
changed overnight.
Just about a year earlier, he asked me for a ride from Venice to Naples, which is an airplane ride, which is maybe a 20-minute ride, and didn't have the money to buy gas. I mean, I said, yeah, I'll take you down there with one of my pilots if you buy the gas. He didn't have the money to buy gas for an airplane to go down and back. And then he shows up a year later and plops $1.7 million or $1.8 million or $2 million on the table as if it was paper money.
Tom Hammersley was the chief flight instructor at Florida Flight Training, the other Dutch-owned flight school at the Venice airport. They trained the terrorist pilot at the controls of the plane which crashed in western Pennsylvania.
I know that he wanted to buy out everybody on the block, so to speak, and have a monopoly on the airport. That was one of his goals. And I really didn't see it as anything else but a Dutch man with a French complex called a Napoleon complex.
So two Dutch nationals had purchased flight schools at the Venice airport in the year before the terrorists began to arrive. Local observers thought that was one Dutch boy too many for coincidence.
It's kind of odd because the only other flight school in town is owned by Arne Kutoff, and he's Dutch. I mean, the odds of that are pretty slim. And
each of those flight schools was purchased in the same year, a year before the terrorists showed up.
About the same time period, yeah.
I've heard a lot of rumors that I haven't been able to substantiate about connections between them and other businesses here and entities and agencies outside the area. It certainly is something you'd have to say is an interesting coincidence.
The notion that it is just coincidence that dozens of Arab student pilots learned to fly at two separate Dutch-owned flight schools at this tiny airport is called the Magic Dutch Boy Theory. Just like the magic bullet theory in the Kennedy assassination, where a magic bullet was the only way the FBI could concoct a scenario which let them apply a lone nut gunman tag to Lee Harvey Oswald. The FBI's explanation of the conspiracy leading to the September 11th disaster only flies through similarly twisted logic. Consider both pilots who guided planes into the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center trained at Dutch national Rudy Dekkers Huffman Aviation, which he had purchased the year before the terrorists began to arrive. The terrorist duo practicing touch-and-goes on Florida's Gulf Coast were soon joined by a third student terrorist pilot, Siad El-Jara, the Lebanese national, at the controls of the plane which crashed in western Pennsylvania, making it a terrorist trifecta out at the Venice airport. He trained at the Florida Flight Training Center, newly purchased by yet another Dutch national. Two Dutch boys buying adjacent flight schools, which shortly thereafter get overrun by terrorists, is one damn Dutch boy too many, one southern lawman told us. It's untidy. Making this even more suspicious is the fact that both Dekkers and Kutoff insist they only met in Venice. Turns out they're lying.
I was also the chief flight instructor down at Florida Flight Training Center, which is on the Venice airport. It's at the opposite end. And I knew Rudy Dekkers. My former employer, Arne Kutoff, and Rudy Dekkers are both Dutch. They go back a long time.
We wanted to ask Arne Kutoff about this, but when he visited his flight school, he tried to threaten us. It didn't work.
You're lucky to sit where you're sitting, because right now if you sat in Rudy's office, well, you wouldn't be.
One common link between the two men is a German national named Pascal Schreier, who recruited students for both men in... Are you ready for this? Hamburg, Germany.
I know Pascal Schreier. I mean, I worked with him as part of Florida Flight Training Center. He's a German boy, and did a lot of recruiting students over in Europe, sending them over to Arne.
The two Venice Dutch boys run supposedly competing flight schools, but strangely, Pascal Schreier has been in business with both of them. According to the French newspaper Le Monde, Swiss police questioned Osama bin Laden's older brother, Yaslam, a key figure in the family's business empire, because one of his companies, Avcon Air Charter, just happened, as they say, to have offered flight training to clients at the Venice flight schools attended by some of the hijackers.
I asked them specifically what their goals were, and they said they wanted to learn to fly so that they could go fly for Saudia. For people coming from that part of the country, Saudia would be the premier airline of the Middle East.
Why haven't we read about this in America's so-called free press? Why are we still accepting at face value the word of a man of such clearly dubious character? Dekkers, for example, was recently forced to settle a lawsuit for sexual harassment filed by an 18-year-old girl. A former employee, it turns out she was also the Huffman employee, who filed the terrorist error-filled INS paperwork, Remember to get the visas that came back 6 months to the day after the attack? Perhaps she can be forgiven her mistakes, given that she was at that same time being distracted by the pawings of a middle-aged Dutch creep.
You're aware of the numerous allegations of sexual harassment, for example.
Yeah, I hear that. I mean, that's rumors around the airport. Airport's smaller community. It's like a small microcosm of society, most airports are. And yeah, women leave, and, you know, down there, I've heard that there's been problems down there.
So a man who gets his kicks by sticking broom handles up the backs of the dresses of 18-year-old girls who work for him was invited to testify before the Congress of the United States of America on preventing future terrorist attacks. Apparently no one thought to question him about what role he may have played or how he may have facilitated the events of September 11th. Why not? As we've just seen, it's not because he has such a sterling character. What then? Why is Rudy Dekkers being protected? And by whom? To understand what follows, it helps to recall first just a little U.S. history. Back in the bad old days of the Cold War, the largest airline in the entire world belonged to just one client, the CIA. The agency operated its airline under literally hundreds of names, constantly shuffled. When CIA Director Helms ordered an inventory of the planes one time, he was told no accounting could ever be anything like totally accurate because of the complexity of the scheme. But in the public revulsion over the excesses of the CIA after Watergate, the agency was forced to divest itself of its air carriers, supposedly. But something like it still goes on today. Take a look at Florida Air. At the same time that Rudy Dekkers was getting humiliating coverage as a deadbeat in the local newspaper, he was also launching a commuter airline. There aren't many people behind on their rent who have the luxury to think about new airlines now, are there? Dekkers had a partner in Washington State. His name was Richard Bulkey. He owned Harbor Air, called the Navy's airline because it serviced the big Whidbey Naval Air Station in Oak Harbor, Washington. Dekkers entered a venture with a partner who was also at the same time participating in the massive mob-led looting of pension funds in Portland, Oregon. Altogether, over $350 million was missing. And they not only got away with it, but they even pretty much kept it out of the papers, except the local press, which just claimed to be sort of puzzled by it all. Dekkers' partner Richard Bulkey was pretty fortunate, too. He gave him $26 million to build this high-rise condominium project that only cost $12 million. Where do you go to apply for that kind of work? Portland reporter Eric Mason was intrigued by the Bulkey-Dekkers connection, too. When he went to interview Bulkey, Bulkey told him he was someone else.
It's interesting, the first, you know, conversation that I had with him, he denied being Richard Bulkey. Mm-hmm.
Recognized him from the description I had gotten. I said, "Mr. Bulkey, can I get an interview with you?" And he said, "Mr. Bulkey isn't here." And then when I saw him again, I said, "Mr. Bulkey, I think you really need to speak to me. I've got some important questions for you." He finally said, "Okay, come on upstairs."
Mason was interested in Bulkey for pretty much the same reasons we were.
The financing that had gone between Mr. Bulkey and Florida Air, which was a sister operation to the flight training center which trained Mohammed Atta.
Remember what we said at the start of the show? That this was a story about legends? That your legend is your cover story, the lie that holds together long enough to let you slip away. Well, oddly enough, Richard Bulkey's condo project in Portland, Oregon, it's called Legends. Rudy Dekkers might be involved in a lot of aviation-related businesses that don't make any business sense, but so is his partner Richard Bulkey.
As Richard Bulkey's former employees always wondered what the aviation business was really doing. From the beginning, they felt as though the finances flowed from the real estate holdings and the retirement home into this aviation company, and that there was really no way this aviation company was really making money. So the question about what this aviation company was really all about, that still remains to be seen.
When things don't make business sense, sometimes it's because they do make sense, just in some other way.
The player started out of here, which was a Decker, a Hilliard thing, which again, just never made sense. That airline startup thing was the chances of that working were, we joked about it. I mean,
In fact, it was such a joke around here at the airport. It was a thing where, you know, I joked around. I said, oh, yeah, they're going to start an airline. I said, I'm working on a shuttle launch facility right next door here.
We are looking, remember, for evidence of the global networks, which authorities said must have been aiding the terrorists while they were in this country.
He had received financing from Capital Consultants. And Capital Consultants, the folks that are the head of, or the financial officers of Capital Consultants, have now been indicted on a number of charges, including fraud. Some have labeled it a Ponzi scheme. I think the prosecutors in this case have made the case, at least to a grand jury, to go forward with indictments, that there was fraud going on. And you have to ask yourself, in this huge financial holdings company, where did all this money go? You have to ask yourself, you know, how much money can you lose and not have anything to show for it?
Another grateful recipient of millions of dollars of the pension fund money was Alvin Malnick, whom Reader's Digest once called Meyer Lansky's heir as head of organized crime. And as global networks go, they don't get much bigger than that. But it's not Malnick's gangster ties that make your jaw drop. It's his connection with the Saudi royal family. The Jewish gangster, Alvin Malnick's son, is married to the daughter of Prince Turki, a leading prince of the Saudi Arabia Kingdom's founding family, who lived in this swank Miami condo project, the Cricket Club, at Malnick's invitation. The Saudi prince not only blessed the marriage, but regularly works with the U.S. Organized Crime Associates. One knowledgeable observer told us he would frequently send his private 747 to Florida to pick up Malnick and his associates so they could conduct business on the plane away from prying eyes. Malnick also owns what law enforcement sources call the biggest mob hangout south of New Jersey, The Forge, which attracts what one investigator called men with big cigars and women with tiny resumes. In front of the Senate Banking Committee hearings about the terrorist money trail and the aftermath of the September 11th disaster, Assistant Attorney General Michael Chertoff said, frankly, we can't differentiate between terrorism and organized crime and drug dealing. Rudy Deckers, it seems, has partners who are in business with the mob, and the mob is a global network, and the mob traffics in heroin, which gives him something pretty big in common with Osama bin Laden's organization, believed to derive much of its funding from the heroin and opium trade in Afghanistan. But there's yet another global network, which often works together with the mob, which has its fingerprints all over the Rudy Deckers story. Take Rudy Deckers Airlines, Florida Air, for example. Just like the CIA's airline back in the 60s and 70s operated under hundreds of names, Deckers Airline does too. Florida Air really isn't Florida Air, for example. It's Sunrise Airlines of Las Vegas, doing business as Florida Air. But then, Sunrise Airlines of Las Vegas isn't really Sunrise Airlines either. It's Express Air of Phoenix, doing business as Sunrise Airlines. Somebody real high in the U.S. government must have loved these guys, because they were getting more than $3 million a year from the U.S. government itself in something called the Essential Air Service Program in the Department of Transportation to run flights in rural Arizona. But it gets better. The plane they flew the service in was donated to them for just a buck a year by the city of Pueblo, Arizona, which obligingly purchased it for them after the city fathers approved a $2 million bond issue. But it gets better yet. After being the recipient of all that government money, Rudy Decker's company didn't even operate the flights. It went bankrupt instead. Deadbeat Rudy Deckers was starting an airline. And how's this for an ironic twist? Who should line up to provide him with his very first celebrity endorsement? But Florida Secretary of State, Katherine Harris. We all remember her. At this point, we wondered, is it just us? Did anyone else see what we were seeing? Well, yes. There is a lot of uneasiness about Rudy Deckers in Venice, Florida, especially among people who know him.
I think in a lot of ways he's very ambitious. To what extent he would go to succeed, I don't know his character well enough to comment on it.
It's common knowledge around the airport that, in fact, the phrase you hear a lot of times is you can't believe what he says. I mean, he doesn't have a lot of credibility.
I've certainly had a number of occasions when Mr. Decker has told me something that turned out not to be true.
They did have somebody, in foreign agent in Hamburg. It was common knowledge that they went after European, the Marcus, and they went after, they had foreign agents. They called them agents.
I mean, after the fact, of course, it looks extremely suspicious. I mean, what are the chances that all the people, or the huge bulk of the terrorists, would train in one or two flight schools in one town?
Exactly. What are the chances? This is a question which the FBI seems desperate to avoid. Take a look at this wanted poster they put out. 2 weeks after the attack, they'd confiscated everything in sight at both Venice Dutch Boys flight schools. So why is the word Venice so conspicuous by its absence in their report? What are they covering up? From his vantage point as the owner of the aviation facility right next door, Coy Jacobs says suspicions about Rudy Deckers have been widespread around the Venice airport since he moved in the year before Mohammed Atta came to town. Since September 11th, the suspicion has only grown more intense.
When people operate suspiciously at airports around here, people start acting suspicious. I mean, law enforcement hovers around most airports in the southeast United States to some extent. They hover around airports around here, obviously, and they were told to stay away from that operation.
Who was told?
The Sarasota County drug interdiction people were told that they had a green light to operate and that they were to stay away from it. They were some type alluded to the fact that they may have some type of government protection.
Government protection of Rudy Deckers? That would explain the softball coverage by CNN. The question was, which part of the government?
It's a published known fact that some people fairly high up in the CIA have started developments around here. I think by developments I'm talking investments after they retired. I would say that it's not the Bush's vacation here.
Rudy Deckers doesn't impress locals as any sort of budding James Bond, but the money man behind Rudy, he's another story.
It seemed like he wasn't quite as astute as I would have thought somebody in the intelligence community would be. I mean, you think of these guys looking like James Bond or, you know, wearing flower shirts and carrying Walther PPKSs. Wally certainly could be. I mean, Wally was unassuming, nice guy, had a cell phone, rang all the time, had an affinity for Learjets.
Do CIA agents have an affinity for Learjets? Was there evidence of a large covert presence in Venice, Florida? Rudy Decker's business partner in Washington State provided the critical clue.
Richard Bulkey started in the business of creating freestanding retirement homes. And he, at one point, had the largest company, the largest holding of these freestanding retirement homes in the country. One of the retirement homes that belongs to the company that Richard Bulkey once held was just a stone's throw from the airport where Mohammed Atta was trained. And you have to ask yourself, there's a lot of coincidences here. Are they just coincidences, or is there something more to it?
In an ironic twist worthy of the spy fiction of Jean Le Carré, it turns out that its elderly population, the very thing that made Venice seem an unlikely terrorist destination resort, was what drew Atta and his cadre here in the first place. American intelligence has had a significant presence here for a long time in, of all things, the nursing care industry. This stately colonial building, just a block from the Venice airport, was built to house the national headquarters of huge nursing care company, started by a man whose name is synonymous with American covert operations during the past several decades, Jackson Stevens. Jackson Stevens' name surfaced in the BCCI scandal, in the MENA drug scandal, in the Promise software scandal, in the Vince Foster scandal. This stately mansion, which still houses Jackson Stevens' law firm, is the house that Jack built. And right across the street is Richard Bulkey's Altera assisted living facility. And just around the corner is Huffman Aviation. Our biggest discovery was that the parcels of land surrounding the Venice airport tell their own story of covert associations. It's the story of America's secret history. Here, Jackson Stevens' law firm, Boone, Boone, and Boone, it still exerts control over the civic destiny of this tiny town. And the founder of the firm was former Florida Governor Lawton Child's college roommate, a detail whose importance will shortly become clear when we look just down the street
where right beside the Venice airport sits the longtime winter home of Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Circus. The circus was brought to Florida, we learned, by its longtime owner, John Ringling North. John Ringling North, back in World War II, was an agent of the precursor of the CIA, the OSS. And not just any agent either. He's credited with securing the release from Italian prisons of key mafia figures who repaid his kindness by assisting in the Allied invasion of Italy in 1944. More than 50 years later, sitting right beside the Ringling Circus grounds, right next door to Jackson Stevens Law Firm, and right beside the Venice Airport, is a parcel of land housing the Italian-American Social Club. They couldn't put this in a movie. No one would believe it. Friday night is pasta night, we're told. We wonder what they do there other nights. As it happens, a traveling circus, which was often touring behind the Iron Curtain during the Cold War, provided excellent cover for intelligence activity. Ringling's winter home beside the Venice Airport also housed the famous Clown College, where for many years the CIA sent recruits as part of their training. Why does a CIA agent go to Clown College? The answer's simple: to learn sleight of hand. And now we've come almost full circle. Because remember Stevens Law Firm's founder's college roommate, Democrat Lawton Childs? Well, oddly enough, it was he who gave Rudy Decker's only celebrity endorser, Republican Catherine Harris, her start in politics when he named her to the board of the Ringling Circus Foundation in nearby Sarasota. They couldn't put this in a movie. No one would believe it. It turns out that Venice, including neighboring Charlotte County, have been hotbeds of covert intrigue for as long as anyone can recall. At least 23 helicopters have been made to disappear from the Charlotte County Sheriff's Department for reasons unknown and sent to exotic and faraway destinations, like Chile.
Charlotte County always had kind of a shadow. There's a fellow that rebuilds helicopters, and he's always been in quasi problems with the FAA with his helicopter parts.
Jamie Hill.
Yeah.
Who the sheriff, the Charlotte County Sheriff, is investigating for the as being involved in the disappearance of 23 of Charlotte County Sheriff's helicopters.
Lose 23 helicopters.
Well, you wouldn't think Charlotte County would need 23.
No, that's, of course not.
Why is this of any interest to us in our story? Because despite what we've been told by the FBI, Charlotte County was the first home in this country of Mohammed Atta. These emails are from Mohammed Atta, discovered by Charlotte County law enforcement, and shown here for the first time. They reveal that Atta was sending email correspondence to people who appear to have been working for U.S. defense contractors, like Virtual Prototype, whose website says the firm helped prototype avionics for the F-15 jet fighter, the F-22 Raptor, the B-2 bomber, and the Apache longbow. We discovered that Rudy Deckers provides regular maintenance to an airline based at Charlotte County Airport, Carib Air, owned by Dietrich Reinhardt, a notorious Iran-Contra operative. Reinhardt also has the distinction of being business partners with the man suspected of making all those helicopters disappear. Deckers does work for a notorious CIA proprietary air carrier with a particularly blemished past, including blemishes like having its aircraft seized at the infamous Mena, Arkansas airport, and being accused by government prosecutors of having used its planes to ship drugs worth billions of dollars into this country. Finally, yet another Iran-Contra operative, Frank Moss, is a conspicuous presence here too. He owns this vintage DC-3. It's painted to look like an airborne ark, which has been sitting at the airport since its seizure 2 years ago. As it happens, our old friend Barry Seal's pals have their fingerprints all over operations in and around Venice, Florida.
We knew that Rudy had a lot of money behind him. We knew he had a lot of money backing him.
I think common sense should prevail. And I think if you're a thinking person and you have common sense, I think that you examine the person making a statement and see if there's any reason for any falsehoods to erupt. And I think that it's pretty suspicious to me.
So much dust in the air, so to speak, that people couldn't really focus on what was perhaps, you know, the true way the Trojan horse got into this country.
In a world where the truth was something more than an inconvenient annoyance,
There might be signs at the edge of this town reading Welcome to Venice, home of the Trojan Horse. We don't live in that kind of world. Maybe we never will. We've just presented an hour's worth of anomalous evidence pointing to the existence of a conspiracy to keep the American people in the dark about the true nature of the tragedy that darkened all our doorsteps last September. We could easily show you several hours worth of anomalous evidence more. But this is the point of the show where we let down our journalistic guard, where I tell you what I think. I think that there's only one thing worse than having to watch human beings jump out of 100-story windows in twos and threes holding hands. And that's having to watch it and then having your government lie to you about who did it and why. I think that the brutal reality of American life as we enter the 21st century is the same as that which faced the citizens of Rome almost 2,000 years ago, when they looked on with despair at the swaggering and corrupt Praetorian Guard that had made a mockery of their once proud republic, and asked out loud the question that echoes down to us across the centuries: who will guard the guards?